Welcome back to another episode of The Debrief, and this week I'm joined by another all-star lineup. As always, John Burgman, covering competitive climbing for Climbing Magazine and also writing for the Climbing Business Journal. And from UKClimbing, Natalie Berry herself, another one of the show's regulars. It's great to have both of you back here on the episode. Before we get started, thanks to everybody who leaves comments in the chat. I wanted to bring that up because the YouTube chat has actually been surprisingly insightful, whether they're right or wrong. Some of the folks that are actually leaving comments on these videos are leaving well thought out and pretty lengthy comments. And so I appreciate the people that watch it that have actual thoughts and not just weird knee jerk, you know, fanatic reactions to talking about particular athletes. So you guys are awesome. Join the Discord if you haven't already. But anyway, we're talking about the event in Chamonix this past weekend, the Speed and Lead World Cup, the third Lead World Cup of the season, and things start to get a little bit spicy. So, to lead it off, as always, our special guest is going to start this off with their headline from the event. So, Natalie, I'm going to hand it over to you. What did you take away from Chamonix?
Yeah, I mean, my headline, maybe it's a bit negative to start off with, but yeah. Undercooked routes make for multiple tops and unhappy athletes. I think there are just far too many tops across the board this weekend. So we've got some numbers as well. Roman Kranik, the Slovenian coach, Janja's coach, actually posted on Instagram, and he went to the trouble of counting through the last three rounds. So he said, in Innsbruck, there were 22 tops across the board, men's and women's, all three rounds. Villars 13, and in Chamonix this weekend there were 69, so over three times as many as there were in Innsbruck, which, yeah, I don't think there's ever been a competition in history which has had as many tops as there were this weekend. And so this, yeah, there were 11 men that got two tops in qualifiers in Chamonix, five women that got two tops in qualifiers, and then nine men went through to the finals, which is just quite crazy. The whole thing just seemed to last forever. And then four out of the eight women topped the final route. So half the field got to the top. And I think throughout the whole of the women's final, at least, it was always like, oh, trying to figure out on count back, you know, who's tied with who? Like, is it going to go down to time? And I just didn't feel like we were concentrating on the actual climbing on that route. It was just trying to think back to previous rounds, going through the results and just feeling a bit all over the place. And I can't imagine what it feels like for the athletes, especially Janja, who in the last two rounds has had a really good final route. You know, she said, oh, it's really hard, I really enjoy it when the climbing routes are, the final routes are difficult, and you can see she's actually fighting and showing what she's got. I think she must have just been sat in isolation, just maybe feeling a bit disheartened. And I think Stasha, in the post-climb interview, she said, oh yeah, I was a bit nervous because I knew I had to top. And, you know, it just takes all the fun out of the finals when you know the route is toppable beforehand and you've just got to try and climb it quickly in case, you know, the person that you tied with in a previous round also tops. So I think for me it was just, yeah, I couldn't really see past that this weekend. And I know a lot of people I've spoken to just, you know, tops are great for the crowd, especially in a place like Chamonix where you've got thousands of people in a public square cheering people on. But it's ultimately for the climbers and for climbing fans, it's not really what it's about. You want to see maybe one top, two at most, but you want to see people actually fighting and not just rushing and slipping, or, yeah, everyone getting to the top and not really feeling happy about it because they know they'll probably get off, knocked off the podium. Like Jessie Piltz, even though she topped, she came fourth. So yeah, that's my headline. And yeah, sorry to start off on a negative note.
No, I think it was the dominant conversation piece. John, I'm going to let you give your reflections first. Please go ahead.
Yeah, I think I'm glad you brought up the frustration from the athletes themselves, Natalie, because that is certainly a big aspect of this. But another aspect, and you hinted at this when fans want to see tops, but only to a certain extent, right? You don't want to see 69 tops in this case. When I was watching, I had a couple of friends send me text messages saying stuff like, I'm a little bored, or this is getting boring. I know people in the Discord were saying some stuff about like, yeah, I'm kind of bored now with so many tops. And I think, I mean, that is probably the worst thing that you can have fans say about the viewing experience, is just to be bored. And especially bored when the climbers are doing exactly what they ideally should be doing, right? They're getting to the top of the route, but yeah, when it results in the viewing experience being actually boring to some people, I want to make it clear, I didn't think it was boring. I did not share that sentiment, but I did receive those messages. That's just really unfortunate.
The dissonance of, you know, one of the draws of Chamonix is it's a climbing town. And so you say, oh, these people really know what's up with climbing, right? You don't need to feed them baby food. You don't need to spoon feed them. Sorry, I'm just mixing metaphors and shit. But so you have this town where we're like, we can put on some real climbing and this crowd will know what's up. And then we also say, well, you know, in Chamonix, they always want a lot of tops. The organizers want a lot of tops for the crowd. And that just, those really are dissonant to me, because you have to assume that crowd is aware that, oh yeah, the first top is great, second top not so much, and by the time you're at the fourth top, that's really disappointing from just like a competitive aspect. So if they're really trying to spoon feed that crowd, then are they really, you know, as knowledgeable as we think they are? I think there's a misunderstanding from the event organizer about what that crowd actually values. I think that's kind of disappointing. I should also state that I'm just going off hearsay, that there's a lot of pressure from this particular organizer. I know Eddie made a post recently. He's mentioned that in the past, that Chamonix has this kind of history. So that always throws me for a loop. The one thing John mentioned about the boredom is as much as I find it unsatisfying, I don't find it boring, especially when we have this, and I'm going to ruin my winner point by talking about this, but what makes it fascinating is there is a bit of expectation this season that Janja is going for the sweep of the lead season. And I think we can all agree that while the climbs from the last 2 weeks were far harder, this was the most difficult World Cup she's had to win so far this season. And these are the kind of events where it does come down to the seconds, and there's not much she can do aside from hopefully climb fast, where that's what it's going to, you know, that's what her season is going to rely on. I think that makes it very interesting. And my hair was raised when Natalia was on the wall and the clock was ticking down, and it really mattered if she was going to sink that top hold or not, which we already knew had been top four times. Natalia was setting great pace up into the end. Like, it wasn't boring, in my opinion. I thought it was really exciting, but you're just disappointed for how the season could have ended, right? And this is where I'm going to ruin my winner's point is this was a huge win for Janja, just kind of for the wrong reasons, and that's a little bit disappointing. You look back at some of the great streaks that never were in climbing history, and it's often not that the person that goes 7 out of 8 or 6 out of 7 or whatever, it's not necessarily that they had a bad performance, it's that at a particular comp, things get easy enough that the margins are so tight where it comes down to that single attempt to zone or, you know, everybody's falling at the exact same crux and you happen to not get a plus, things like that, right? And so these are the comps that you have to survive to get those rare streaks. And so Janja had a really big win today, as much as it was less impressive in terms of climbing than her last two wins, which were so dominant. And just the eye test showed how strong a climber she was. This was probably the hardest win of the season so far. And if there's more comps like this, this is where she really has to watch out to preserve that streak.
Yeah, I'd say I agree with that. I don't think it was boring per se, but like, there's definitely some tension watching Natalia climb, like, is she going to top out, and mm-hmm. like Janja fist pumping and wondering if that would like cost her the win. Like, it's kind of ridiculously exciting, as you say, for all the wrong reasons. But I think for me, the reason why it's so disappointing, especially as it always seems to happen the women's round, like not so much in the men's final, like they seem to be able to tweak, like fine, there were 22 tops and qualifiers for the men's, but for the finals they adjusted and they did a relatively good job of it. But for the women, they always seem to struggle with getting the difficulty just right, and there's always more tops in the women's event. And Stasha was very eloquent on the live stream saying, like, you know, is this because we don't have enough female route setters and testers, like forerunners trying the routes? And you know, apparently the route setters had said, oh, there's no rests in it at all, and then all the girls were, well, the women were finding knee bars and back steps and sort of contorting themselves. And you know, it is, I think she has a point that if men are forerunning, then they can't fit into those spaces. And I think the nature of the wall as well, with those volumes sticking out, a lot of the women could like push into corners and like sit and rest and get high heels on the big, like the big black holds. And yeah, I think it just body shape, it makes such a big difference on how well you can rest on things. And yeah, I think Stasha had a really good point that we definitely need more female route setters and forerunners to check these things.
Yeah, and it's going to be interesting to watch the rest of this lead season and see if, to what extent this is a trend, or if this was just an oddity, one-off anomaly event, right? Because if you go back to Roman's post, other comps, that's not that bad in terms of that many tops. This top, this competition in Chamonix was just exponentially more than before, it seemed like. So we'll see if this is a thing, a continuation as the season goes on. The other thing that's interesting about it is, think about how the Boulder season concluded, with those last couple of competitions being Natalia had to top in order to win, right? Because Hannah had performed so well. So Natalia, as the last climber, she gets on the boulder and it's like, okay, she has to top it in order to win. In some cases, she has to top in two attempts or whatever. We think going to the lead season, the whole dynamic or the whole ethos of that is going to change. It's not about tops and lead, of course. It's just about theoretically who gets the highest on the wall. And yet here we are in Chamonix, quite literally feeling more like the end of the bouldering round in terms of Janja goes to the wall, and it's like, well, she has to top this and flash it, obviously, because of the format. She has one attempt. She's got to get to the top, or else she will lose. And so kind of taking a little bit of that boulder ethos into the lead season, which is probably not a great thing, but we'll see.
I was so ready to savor the drama and I mentioned this in the Discord, but you know, Janja kind of gifted Natalia that entire boulder season. Like Natalia sweeping all those events would have been much harder if Janja had showed up. And then to imagine Natalia pays back that favor by ruining Janja's streak in the lead season just by climbing a little bit faster would have been so satisfying. And part of me still kind of wants that. I feel like if there's anything to create a genuine, you know, blood-spitting rivalry, it would be something like that. I thought that'd be awesome. I want to go back to something Natalie just mentioned. And the topic of, like, too many tops comes up, it happens all the time, right? There's always going to be one or two events each season where it's too easy. And I am a little bit despondent about the topic because, you know, people have been route setting and setting these comps for decades and it still happens. And I don't really know what the solution is most of the time. Like we say, well, oh, the setters need to be better or whatever. And I don't really know what exactly the practical answer is there. Like, do we need these route setters to have more information? Do we need them to have more physical training? Like, what is it that we need to do to make sure we avoid results like this? And I don't think there is a practical answer. I think this is what you get. But Stasia's discussion was one of those few areas where you say, oh, there is a workable solution, which is for women's climbing in particular, is get some female forerunners on these climbs. And that is a doable thing that makes sense, that it would actually possibly have some effect. And I think it's worth trying. Once that happens, if there's still the same issue in women's climbing in particular, then maybe it's a dead end and we just have to live with it. But I think that is something that, you know, probably hasn't been tried very much. I don't really know what the forerunning budget for these things is, but I'm guessing it's not that much. I'm guessing it's a tight timeline, all of those restrictions. But it's certainly something that really does need to be tried before we can say we've exhausted all the options. So it was refreshing to hear her bring that up, which I'm sure a lot of people wouldn't have the balls to say on a broadcast, criticizing the power of the structure as it exists. So yeah, I thought that was great. But yeah, anyway. John, tell me what was your headline from this whole thing?
My headline is, to an extent, a continuation of what Natalie just said about all the tops, because I think all of the tops play into my headline as well. which is that Chamonix delivers what I think is one of the weirdest, for lack of a better word, weirdest competitions of recent memory. Let's go through some of the peculiarities here that happened throughout the weekend. Let's start with the speed discipline. Kiramal sets a world record in qualification. Now, that's certainly not weird, but it's noteworthy. It immediately makes this competition more memorable than some other competitions. But then Kiramal slips in the opening race of the men's final. And that's totally fine. He's human, obviously. But that just kind of set this tone for some surprises, some eye-raising moments. In the opening heats of the women's speed final, then, Yufang Zhi doesn't start. She pulls out due to an injury. We're never really given, at least I didn't hear it, an explanation of exactly what that injury was, but her opponent then, Dai Nui, gets an automatic berth into the next bracket. So again, that's a bit of a surprise there. And then in the men's final speed final bracket, Eric Noya gets all the way to the big final based on slips from his opponents. Now, I like Eric a lot, and all the credit to him, because he still had to climb and not slip. But I think we can all agree that there was just a string of really good luck there, good fortune, that allowed him to... I mean, every race that he lined up for, I was like, okay, you know, I was lucky the last race, but like this race, we'll actually have to see something neck and neck. And then there'd be a slip, and Eric would go forward, and then the next heat, same thing, gets all the way to the big final. So just plenty of weirdness in speed, and I remember when I was watching it, I was thinking, oh, that was kind of a weird speed portion. Like, that was kind of strange. Little did I know the strangeness was going to continue, because then in the lead discipline, a lot of other weirdness. Just to cherry-pick a couple incidents, Laura Rigora, she reaches the top of the route in semifinals. She actually makes there was a little bit of a dyno to the top, and Laura does it, which is exciting. We're like, oh, Laura, that's awesome, right? We can see some evolution in her skill set there, being able to stick that. Then she gets downscored for dabbing on a bolt, and then she gets re-awarded the top. So it turns out the downscore, never mind about that. Then you have Brooke Rabatou, another instance. She gets downscored because she topped... or she gets downscored because she timed out in semis. And turns out, I didn't know it at the time, but Brooke was dealing with a mild concussion this whole event. If people read her Instagram, she took a really nasty fall in training. So that's just unfortunate in and of itself. Then you had Alex Magos in the men's semis. He gets downscored for stepping on a draw, or for weighting the draw with his hand inadvertently. So other weirdness there. Natalie, you mentioned just the uniqueness of having 9 men instead of 8 go into finals. And then to top it all off, the show seemingly concludes with Luka Podicar, poor guy, he gets brought out on stage as kind of presented as the bronze medalist, even though the screen says Sean Bailey. Luca seems to know that. If you watch the broadcast, he's cordial, but he's kind of stone-faced. I think he knows he wasn't the bronze medalist, but they bring him out there anyway. And then the men are walking off the stage, and Sean Bailey kind of hops on and gives this little wave like, hey, remember me? I'm actually the real bronze medalist. So there's the photo. Yeah, there's the 3 men walking off, and Sean, you know, got a little – he deserved the recognition. So – all that is to say, going back to the headline, just what a weird string of events from the very start with the speed to the very end with the men's podium. A lot of peculiarity to this one, to say nothing of all the tops that we just talked about at length.
Yeah, Natalie, I think
go ahead.
Eric Noya, he reminded me, like, his streak of luck reminded me a bit of Alberto in Tokyo with the, like, Colin slips and then bicycles out. He's like Spanish luck or something. But he was loving it. He looked like he was having such a fun time in the finals. I was really happy for him.
Just in general, yeah, the vibe was, it was one of those speed events where it did just seem like upsets and unfortunate falls at the very last minute or slips right at the top. The one thing that was nice is that not too many false starts. Like, false starts for me are way worse than falls. Falls are exciting, or slips are exciting, but the false starts are really unsatisfying. Going into the one in particular that just, from I don't know why it resonates with me, guys. I didn't even see it live, but the Magos thing, like the unluckiness of you have the foot slip as your finger is in the draw while you clip. Like, that's such a split second moment for people that climb and clip that fast, and for that to be the moment that your foot cuts out is just such bad luck. I don't know what else to say. That's just such shitty news. Did we mention the Jesse Grouper thing where he flagged or kind of like toe hooked the edge of the wall or something like that, like one of the out edges? Yeah, just all these crappy little things came up, but I think that stuff might come up later in somebody else's topic, so we'll leave it at that. My headline was just seeing Adam Ondra back. It's that simple. What else is there to say? And I mean, the cherry on top, he wins the event. It was kind of an unusual win. Taisei Homma's, I know it's two events in, but he's a really interesting character so far, coming out so early in finals and then doing so well and having those scores hold up. Ondra managed to beat him on countback, but anyway, back to Ondra rather than talking about Taisei accidentally. It's great to have, you know, I think with the Janja conversation, we talk so much about, is she the greatest of all time, that we forget to just say it's great to have somebody that's so dominant in the moment. Like, Janja is, she's the greatest of today. She's the best female climber in the world right now. And Ondra is unarguably the best male climber in the world right now. And so it's great that he is actually back here taking part in the competitions, because just like Janja does, he makes so much of it look so easy. And he's, I think, especially having taken such a long break, he looked so appreciative of the sport and the crowd and the moments and the climbing. It looked like, you know, after the Olympic year where everybody was tired, everybody was a bit salty about the system and the lockdown. He, of course, had not a great Olympic experience. Previous to the Olympics, he wasn't competing as much, but he had a couple rough comps, like a low fall in Innsbruck, a little bit injured. So his roller coaster over the last year was pretty rough on him. And so it was really nice to see one of the biggest stars of our sport come back, have a great time, put on an awesome show, and just be gushing about it, right? Like, on the stage, in the interview, with the audience, in the Instagram post afterwards. He was incredibly, aside from absolutely dodging the cameraman on that fist bump, which is prime meme material forever, it felt so satisfying to have somebody that is such a good climber to express so much love for the sport, which is kind of what it felt like a couple weeks ago in Innsbruck when Janja came back and also climbed the shit out of those routes and then was again just smiling from ear to ear. Like, it's just been a couple really satisfying events in terms of seeing great climbers climbing great and then expressing so much love for it. So Ondra's back in the best stop on the circuit, in my opinion. It just felt great.
Also worth remembering that he's a new dad as well. Baby must be a few months old now, so I know, yeah, it's not quite as impressive as mother's coming back post birth, but it's still, I'm sure he's, yeah, had some sleepless nights. But maybe we should call him Dad Amondra.
Yeah, there you go. That's good.
Yeah, we'll like, see.
As well, like two dads on the circuit now.
Well, I was going to say that the entire Czech team at this point, Adam and Martin, should just start, like, they could just start training, just having their kids on their back and, you know, hey, kid, do you want to see what it's like to climb a World Cup route? Strap in and just take him up on his back. This is very offhand and not prompted. So, Natalie, do you know of any female athletes that continued climbing after having a kid? Like, I can't, there's a couple that maybe did, but I can't be sure.
Like, yeah, like Olga Bibic, like years ago.
How old?
I think she came back post birth. Russian boulderer, his name escaped me. There's quite a few. I think there's more than you think. I don't think anyone can come through and like absolutely wipe the board, but maybe we'll see that. Maybe we'll see a comeback.
Okay, cool. Cool. Anyway.
Not necessarily World Cup related, but back in the day, I know that Bobby Bensman had a kid and then came back and won the Phoenix bouldering contest, which was pretty awesome. So
that's an outdoor comp, right?
It is.
Yeah. Okay. I can't remember how that one works. It always, I get it confused with all the other events down in the South, but cool.
The big thing, the only thing I wanted to add about Adam Ondra's win and his excitement, his enthusiasm and why it's so great is because of all the athletes on the World Cup scene who you would kind of understand if they didn't have any interest in competing at this point. It's Ondra, right? I mean, he's the one more so than anybody that could very easily leave the competition scene behind and go out and just do outdoor stuff and continue making a comfortable living. Mm-hmm. So it's just that kind of added to you had to smile when you were seeing him gush about how happy he was to be back at the comp scene, because you're thinking like, this guy doesn't, you know, he could just as easily have walked away after the Olympics and still have this historic career, world championships, World Cup gold, all that stuff. But he's just as happy as seemingly he was when he won his first World Cup gold years and years ago. So good stuff.
That's a good point. And I'm not the person to look into this because I don't care. But it might be an interesting historical thing to look at. Who are the climbers who are considered the tip of the spear in terms of outdoor development? Because I imagine Adam Ondra is kind of considered that right now outside. He is the guy that is pushing the very highest grades. He is the one creating the climbs with the very highest grades. And he's also bothering to still show up to comps, right? Even though his whole comp career has been, you know, show up this year, don't show up next year. He's like off and on, but he still shows up and still seems to love it. That would be a fun thing that I would love to learn from somebody else, is where were those moments in history where the people getting the gold medals in the World Cups were the same people that were outside tearing up those biggest routes? Because I feel like a lot of the time it's one or the other. Anyway, that'll be a fun thing to learn more about. Let's go to big winners. Natalie, let's start with you.
Yeah, I'm going for the British option. He's got a Scottish name, but he's got Scottish family, but doesn't live up here. Hamish MacArthur making his first final of the season. He's only 20, and he won two golds at the World Youth Championships last year in Lead and Boulder, and of course won silver in the World Championships in Lead in Russia last year, and was very close to making the finals of the Boulder as well. So I think a lot of us, and I think Hamish himself, had a lot of expectation coming into this season. And I think he was a little bit disappointed in his results so far. Like in Boulder, he made at least one semi-final. I'm pretty sure he qualified like second in his group in the qualifiers in Innsbruck bouldering. But didn't really stand out. I think he may be expected to make a final at least. And then so far in the lead, he's been 25th, 29th, and now 7th. So he'd only made one semi-final in lead this season before Chamonix. And he posted on Instagram, he was like, I think I finally found my mojo again. So he'd definitely been a little bit frustrated, you know, after the high of last year and then struggling to get into it a little bit, but yeah, he looked really happy. There's a photo of him with a like massive grin once he realized he'd made finals. I think he looked a little bit nervous in the finals, like he climbed quite tense, but for him that was a really good result. I think he's definitely one to watch out for, both him and Max Milne, for Paris 2024. I think they're two of our biggest hopes for GB climbing, for sure. Good start to the, well, not start, but yeah, hopefully. I think he'll grow in confidence from that. He said he wants to win the Olympics, so.
Yeah. Who, after, you know, Team GB was kind of similar to what Canada experienced for a while, where we have one talismanic climber, in your case being Shauna Coxie for so long, and then their career is over, and you've got a deep pool of talent. Like, we see British climbers in semifinals and finals at nearly every event at this point, between the boys and Molly Thompson Smith in particular. Can you tell us a little bit about what you know right now about the training situation, the team situation in Great Britain? Like, is it a pretty unified scenario where everybody's training together, or are they all pretty separate, or some living in different countries? Like, what's going on there?
Yeah, so historically Sheffield has been like the training hub, and that's where all the top climbers live and train. Everyone moves there. Everyone like quits uni and just moves straight to Sheffield, right, and training on the grit, training at the works, and all the climbing walls popping up there. But I think increasingly, like, the British climbers are climbing together a lot more. They're kind of doing their own thing outside of like official team meetings. A lot of them live together, travel together. They seem like a really cohesive unit at the moment. I think it's really working out well for them. And some of them, like Hamish and Max, they're based in Leeds, and Holly Tootle as well. Tootle, thank you, Brandon. So Leeds is kind of this up-and-coming training hotspot in the UK. They've got some good bouldering walls. They've got a good local coach that kind of coaches a lot of them privately. And that seems to be making a difference. There's like a lot of climbers are choosing like Leeds universities or just moving straight to Leeds over Sheffield now, purely to focus on competition climbing. Like, they're not that interested in tri climbing or gritstone, which, you know, traditionally a lot of the climbers go to the peak for. But so Leeds is like a new centre for competition training. And I think, just being able to bounce ideas off each other, just push each other in training, competitions, and also just get this really close friendship that I think actually helps. Like, you see it in the Slovenian and the American teams, like, that they are really good friends in and outside of competitions, where I think in the past, I think Brits, we're a bit more reserved, we're a bit keep ourselves to ourselves, but it's nice to see more of a family, like, you know, family and friends kind of community growing around the competitions and, yeah, pushing each other on.
Oh, that's cool.
Do you know how involved at all, is Shauna Coxie? Like, is she seen with them at all, or is she just kind of really separate from the comp scene, from the Great Britain, like the national stuff that's going on there at this point?
Yeah, I mean, I think a lot of the time, like, especially in the lead up to the Olympics, she's had her own coaching, like specific training regime and stuff, and her own coaches. And obviously now, like, she's just had a baby, so she's not really climbing so much or just trying to get back into it. I think when she was competing on the World Cup, she was still a figurehead for the team, but I don't think outside the circuit she was like necessarily training with the other member, like coaching them or anything. But, you know, she's still really supportive of the others, and I think in, you know, organized training sessions she would be there, and people would, you know, try and measure themselves up against her and stuff, mm-hmm. and she would kind of pull them up. I think she's had a huge influence on the other athletes, and also like media. Like, Max did well, and every time, you know, a British climber does well, like, the BBC is taking more interest in the sport. So she's really done a huge amount for competition climbing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's interesting because I kind of, just because they retired at the same time, I think of her and Akio Noguchi kind of with the same questions, like how involved are they going to be in retirement with the competition side of things? It's not totally a fair comparison because, as you said, Sean has just had a child and Akio has not. But I know, for example, a lot of fans were surprised to see Akio at the Salt Lake City World Cup this year. She showed up and she was doing media stuff and she was there with the team and stuff like that. So that kind of made me wonder, I wonder if Sean is going to, you know, after obviously the motherhood stuff is first and foremost, but is she going to kind of be a part of the squad, traveling with the squad at all, maybe coaching or at least just moral support? I don't know. So I'll be curious to see.
Still on the Athletes Commission on the IFSC. Yeah. I think that'll be probably her focus point for the next few years. And she's also got a lot of projects she wants to do outdoors as well. So I think that'll probably, yeah, that'll be where she'll end up heading off in that kind of direction, going outdoors a lot, but still having a hand in the competition stuff with the IFSC.
John, what's your big winner from Chamonix?
Yeah, there was several that I wanted to talk about. I mean,
yeah, I don't even know what you're going to choose at this point. You kind of posited like three.
I did. I'll leave a couple of those maybe for honorable mentions. I will go with Sean Bailey. Cool. I mentioned him at the end of the headline that I talked about. Last year, the 2021 season, in both the boulder and lead disciplines, if you kind of combine them, I think Sean Bailey was the big star for the American men. To take nothing away from Nathaniel Coleman, who had his own stardom kind of separately with the Olympics and all that whirlwind. But yeah, Sean was, I mean, he was put on such a pedestal last year, rightly so. He had an amazing 2021 season. I think then this season, a lot of fans, maybe fairly or unfairly, were kind of waiting for a similar breakout performance or some similar breakout moments. And I say that's not quite fair, because it's like you might only get, you know, a gold or a couple golds once in your entire career. So it's not a guarantee that there's ever going to be a sequel to a phenomenal season. And yet we hadn't really seen quite the caliber of you know, podium places to that extent like we did last year from Sean. He didn't get on a podium. He was, I think, 9th and 16th in Salt Lake City or something like that. He had a 47th place in Meyringen, a 31st in Brixen, if I recall correctly. So a little lower than maybe those fans were expecting, like fans that just saw him in the headlines last year and were like, wow, Sean Bailey, first place. You know, they might have been a little surprised when they look in the results and see 47th or 31st. But if there's anything that is so admirable about Sean, it's just his ability to put his head down and keep grinding, right? And we saw it also when he came back after the Pan Ams a couple years ago. He just has this ability to just stay determined, stay the course, even if maybe the results are a little less than he expected, or maybe a little less than the fans expected. I don't want to speak for Sean, but because of all that, it was just great to see him get back on a podium. Climbed well throughout the whole weekend. As anybody who listens to this show knows, I'm a big Sean Bailey fan, so I was really personally stoked for him. It's just awesome stuff to see him get a medal again to in 2022.
Did he get a medal though? I don't know. Most people watching would be surprised. Yeah, I always have a little bit of trouble, especially when the standard is set, for instance, in the season before, where it's about the golds and it's like, wow, look at these, you know, multidisciplinary golds. And was there a back-to-back gold from him in 2021? I can't remember, but it is hard to then accept that the next season winning a bronze is a success. But I think it is notable that, particularly in men's climbing, what you just said, there's no guarantees that the next year around you'll have the same kind of results as before. And that's such it messes with your head, because the story is almost so opposite on the women's side of climbing, where if you win one gold medal in a discipline, that's a predictor that you're probably going to win a bunch of them, right? It's such a different paradigm of what like great success is. But no, I think that's worth contextualizing for the men, that it is a big deal to be making podium spots for 2 years, and I'm hopeful that the rest of his season is good. I mean, we've noticed some changes in his coaching, and we'll see how that plays out, but it sounds like he's been working more closely with people of a Slovenian heritage, and so maybe that ends up bearing fruit. Maybe a new perspective is something that helps him out, or maybe it's just getting rid of that outdoor rust after a season outside and starting to find his flow again. I don't know, but I'm also a fan of Sean Bailey. He's hilarious. I appreciate that he made that stunt going out to the podium. I think that's great. I love those moments, even though it's in cat, like it's only going to be remembered for a crappy low res, you know, little screenshot. I doubt there's a photographer that caught that moment, but yeah. Anyway,
It's something real fast here. Yeah. Something else that's important to mention with Sean Bailey, because I think this also applies to Adam Ondra, which is the fandom of this. Sean Bailey, I think, brings in a certain kind of fan, and Adam Ondra does, meaning maybe the more casual fan that is kind of more familiar with the real rock type of thing, that maybe doesn't know some of these names that are just solely competitors on the competition circuit, on the World Cup circuit. But if people don't watch the competitions, don't watch the World Cups regularly, I think most of them, if they're climbers, they still know, they obviously know like Adam Ondra, and I think they know Sean Bailey and all of that. So those guys in particular do a really good job and have a really crucial role in bridging the gap, I think, between the outdoor fan and the competition fan.
I think that's a really good point too. Yeah. My winner I gave away in the headline. So I'm going to change it. I'm going to change it to Stasia and Emil. I know we've talked about this in the past, and there's only so much I can say about good quality commentary, but it was really nice to have two commentators for Emil was what, semis, and Stasia was finals, right? Yeah, they're both well spoken. They're both strong in English, even though I don't think that's I don't believe it's Emil's native language. I know he's from Sweden, so I'm assuming it's a second language. As much as he has a video background and Stasia not really, they both do a great job, and Stasia has personality and Emil's well spoken and articulate and knows what he's talking about. And I know they're not gonna get these two particular climbers for every event, but I like that we're starting to have the opportunity to condition our audience to what good commentary, what good conversation, and what good banter is between if we want to stick with the structured version of it, having a play-by-play commentator and a color commentator. I like that we're getting more exposure to really good duos rather than, and unfortunately it happens a lot in speed, where there's not necessarily a lot of articulate English speakers at a speed event, or that are speed climbers, and a lot of them just don't have as much experience in media. That's because when you climb speed climbing, you're considered a troll in this sport, and you're an outsider, and I don't know, you live under a bridge or something. It is nice having that opportunity, and it reflected so much in the interviews in particular. Just answering concise but interesting questions, and then Stasia in particular, where she went the entire opposite direction, where the interviews were just carried by camaraderie. She was talking to her friends, and it brought out entirely different answers and a completely different mood and personality than you would by having somebody go up and trying to ask a very professional question, kind of the angle that I would probably take if I was thrown into, you know, I'd be like, okay, I just want a really good question. What's the question I can ask that brings out, you know, a unique bit of information? Whereas Stasia went in and she was just getting faces. She was getting these just incredible reactions, being honest and talking with someone who you've clearly, you know, traveled the circuit with a bunch. And that was really so fun. And I almost liked it more than just getting, that question that nobody's thought of. I thought the way she approached it was really good. And it did end up getting intriguing answers. She loosened, you know, Adam up in particular to just let him talk about what he loved and didn't love about the experience. And they were smiling the whole time. So I thought that was a huge win. I know it's not permanent. I know they only get who they can get from week to week, which is too bad, but I thought they were great. And as much as Dan and Marky has kind of become a bit of a regular on the scene, it just goes to show that when he's not there, there are still options. And importantly, we're getting some different flavors, and we can kind of start to decide, okay, what do we want from climbing commentary? Which I think, with only a single high-tier circuit of competitive climbing, we're not going to have a lot of choice. We're not going to have a lot of options to hear different ways that people tell the stories of competitive climbing in commentary. So it's nice that we do get to sample some of these great voices. So big win for Emil and Stasia. I thought it was awesome.
I've said before, and I'll say it again, I'm generally not a big fan of just pulling in athletes to do commentary. I think commentary, and interviewing for that matter, is a skill, and it should be treated like a skill that somebody, you know, has fine-tuned over time. that's not to say you have to necessarily get in somebody to do commentary that's been to broadcasting school or something like that. I think people like Megan Martin and Dannon are fantastic because they have put in the time to train and kind of hone that craft a little bit. But whenever I say that I don't like them bringing in just athletes to do the co-commentary, I always put this little footnote by it saying with a few exceptions. And those few exceptions, when I think of people that come to mind, Stasha is one of those exceptions. Alana Yip is also, I don't think we've heard her this season, but she's always really good on commentary as well. Now we can add Emil to that list. I think there are some athletes that do a really great job in the co-commentary spot, despite the fact that they are maybe not trained or don't have a ton of practice doing it. I know in Stasha's case, though, she's done it a number of times. I just thought Stasha and Emil did a really wonderful job this weekend. So thumbs up for me on that, too.
Yeah, I enjoyed it. I think, Stasha is a fan favorite. I know everyone, like, apparently they were getting comments like, oh, the best duo ever and stuff. So it's really great. It brings that kind of excitement to it. And it's interesting. I always wonder about, potential conflicts, like being an athlete and being a journalist. Like one time I tried to get a press pass while I was competing. I think it was the Vail round or something, and I wasn't allowed to get a press pass because I was an athlete, and said you can't do both, so it was like one or the other. Sometimes I worry about that, but I think everyone's who does the commentary, has common sense, and they're not gonna, slag off another athlete or something. And I think it's good. I think it's also building skills in athletes that they can use in retirement. They can get into media. There's enough of them now that, like Stasha, have done it multiple times. And as you say, like the more you do it, the more you improve. And yeah, it's potentially a sort of a form of income or a career path after they finish competing.
Yeah, hopefully one day. Hopefully it's income eventually. It doesn't sound like it is at the moment, but. Do you guys mind if I start the losers? All right, I'm gonna get mine out of the way because mine's the flimsiest, and you guys have some actual reasonable opinions. I wanted to mention the wall, and this is the kind of I'm coming from a very subjective angle, so you can discount this if you want. First of all, teal is like my least favorite color, so having teal volumes didn't psych me out, but.
The loser is teal.
The loser is teal. It reminds me of a particular friend. He would always have his MSN messenger text in the color teal back when we were 10 years old, and it will never anyway, about the wall specifically, I really like the old Chamonix wall. I thought it was one of the most distinctive and iconic walls on the circuit. Chamonix updates their walls like every 5-ish years, so I know they don't last that long, and that's fine. I appreciate an event organizer investing in updating their wall, keeping it current, whether that's just making sure it looks really nice, which the current one is certainly very presentable. I just don't like some of the stylistic choices, and I worry about the function a little bit. The key feature of the previous Chamonix wall was the giant red triangular protrusion in the center, which I thought made it look incredible. And for the most part, I don't think affected route setting too much as it extended the head wall down. And if you wanted to go up the center of the feature, you would be taken out of the steep a little bit sooner. And I do think the route setters try and stay in the steep for as long as they can to keep the routes at a high level, considering how strong all of these climbers are. This new wall breaks that feature kind of into four, and now you have this line of four triangular-ish, mock volumes, giant features on the wall. Not as big as the previous one, but now you've got this string of four of them. So as much as the color is garbage, I don't enjoy this style, really. I want the wall to look a bit more blank. Having one kind of central feature that it all kind of coalesces around is fine with me, but stylistically, this is not my vibe. And it felt like through a lot of the rounds, the climbs, for the most part, did try to avoid or snake around those features. Now, part of that may have been you don't want to put them on more you know, straight up vertical angles than you have to, because it makes it easier. You don't want to give them the opportunity to stem or press into something, but also it like possible fall hazard, which is something that I know Natalie brought up in our chain coming into this, that maybe there was some worry that depending on where you fell, you might end up falling into a ledge or into the apex of a triangle sticking out of the wall. There was a conversation I had with Jason Kale, probably on this channel, although maybe it was separate. We were talking about Jason Kale's approach to designing climbing walls, and his walls feature a lot of tessellations and a lot of small shapes to create big curves or patterns in the wall. And I kind of always asked him, you know, my experience in climbing walls where there's lots of angle changes means it's very hard to set consistently, and you often end up using the wall as a feature to grab. How do you get away with it? And his explanation was, you know, the angle differences on my walls are so small. Like when you see the Jason Kale hexagons or whatever, he's dealing with angle differences of 1 or 2 degrees. But with the color change, that's enough to give this sense of some kind of protruding shape or some actual dimension to the wall, even though the actual angles are extremely slight. And I kind of wish that they had taken more of that approach on this wall, where rather having these faux volumes that are quite prominent off the wall, I wish they had kept the same shape, the same size, but just dial back the prominence so that the angle change is much less, but you still get the same visual impact. And I think it would let the root setters actually climb through those shapes a lot more, rather than having these really big domineering surfaces that change up the surface so much. So I don't like how it looks, and I think it, just judging by the qualifiers, photos from qualifiers, semifinals, and a bit from finals, it does seem like they're kind of avoiding those features. So to me, that seems like a bust, in my opinion. And I know half of that is entirely subjective, so you can have your own opinion. But for me, the wall was a downgrade from the previous Chamonix wall.
Yeah, I think for me, the issue, as I mentioned before, is if you start creating quite big angle changes with, you know, massive volumes, you kind of end up with rests, especially for women. Like if the hold's good enough on a slightly different slabbier angle because it's offset on a hold than you on a volume, then yeah, you're just creating like little alcoves where they can sort of nestle into. And I think maybe that's where part of the issue of the root setting this weekend lies, just in too much going on, really hard to predict how people of different shapes and sizes would move between those angle changes. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I have to put a bookmark in this kind of and maybe come back to it next year, because I know you had asked me this, Tyler. You'd brought this up during the event, and I said, it's just so hard to separate what I think of the wall from the fact that we're just getting top after top after top. Now, maybe they are, combined. Maybe they, like Natalie was saying, maybe one is responsible for the other, but I think before I fully assess the wall, I want to see what happens next year at Chamonix, assuming they come back, you know, and after that, because I think your points are really valid, Tyler, about it. As a historian, I love keeping around the old walls and stuff like that. So we'll see. But yeah, some odd choices in the design of this one, in the structure of this one, and probably played a part, or maybe played a part in the 69 tops that we saw. So we'll see what happens next year.
I was considering, I wanted to, and I just decided not to because I was lazy, but I wanted to do an Instagram kind of retrospective of all the different Chamonix walls, because it's one of those few venues that's been around for so long where you have like 6, 7, 8 different wall iterations. And some of them, especially when you get to the old stuff, are hilarious. Like when wood paneling, like colored wood paneling first shows up, but the walls are still designed like the old, I shouldn't say when wood paneling shows up, kind of like when the Walltopia era of paneling shows up and it's just big block colors. There were some great, just like, it just looked like a transformer, just ridiculous angles all over the place, like an inverted Arco wall. But yeah, that's if you love that kind of stuff, go back and look at the evolution of the Chamonix wall, because there's been some really interesting iterations over time. Maybe I'll do that post next year or something. But anyway, John, we'll just reverse the order for the losers. John, what was your loser from Chamonix?
Yeah, I'll go back to speed. I will say my loser is Reza. He slipped, kind of bumbles the top in a race in the the men's final
again. He was gonna win that race. Yeah.
Yeah, I think he was racing Aspar of Indonesia, and he bumbles the top, and he is just so frustrated. He's screaming and he kicks the wall really hard when he's being lowered on the auto belay. I love the intensity in general, and I think as people that cover the sport here, I think we probably agree that usually it's more fun to cover the athletes that maybe run a little hot or wear their emotions on their sleeve, as opposed to an athlete that just shows no emotion at all. Yeah. Obviously, case by case basis, but in general, like I said, I like the intensity. I love it that he runs a little hot, so I don't have a problem with screaming, being frustrated, being just openly a little upset with yourself or whatever it is. That's all totally fine and understandable. But when he kicks the wall really hard like that, I don't know if he got a flag for it, but it's a little disrespectful to the sport, I suppose. It's just a bad look for people watching, for kids at a time when we have more kids watching speed than ever because of the Olympics and stuff. I didn't like it. I didn't like that Reza did that. Now, I'm not going to make a huge deal about it because it's just this one instance. It happened in the heat of the moment, so I think we can all just move on from it. But, I don't know. It stuck with me as just an unfortunate aspect.
I was really torn in that moment because when we talk about Reza being the loser in this case, there's also this kind of arc of, Reza had an incredible peak in the past, and he is, particularly from where he's from, he's a legendary climber, world record holder, and you could argue that his record was really before its time. You can debate that if you want to. So they're part of the loser angle for me is he's dealing with a really hard part of his career. I think he's underperforming. He wants to be making it through deep into the finals, which he really has not been doing lately. And that has to hurt a lot, as he expressed on this. So as he's coming down, as he's screaming, I can relate to all that. I love it. But there is kind of and I'm sure this line is different for every person, but he crossed a line from I'm really sympathetic with you, or I feel empathy for what you're experiencing, and then across the line into this is a little bit embarrassing when you start kind of, I guess, like acting out. And so that was hard for me to reconcile in my personal narrative for this, was I do feel really bad for him. I respect him so much. I've heard so many good things about him as an athlete and as a person. And it was just little moments like that where it just goes over the line for me, where I'm like, that kind of made me uncomfortable as a viewer. And yeah, it feels like that should be a yellow card, but.
I think considering, like, I do wonder where the line is for the IFSC, because if Jesse Grupo got a yellow card for unknowingly continuing on a route, like, you'd think kicking the wall or like kicking a chalk bag or just showing that level of aggression would also be a yellow card. But yeah, I don't know how they handled it.
I would think a pretty firm line, you would think, if you're actually
attacking the infrastructure,
inflicting force or whatever, upon the field of play, upon the field of play, upon the equipment, whatever you want to call it. I just think that's a pretty obvious crossing of the line.
But again, it's
and I
a
like
talking
the guy
point.
Too. I want to echo what you said, Tyler. Too, I like him too, and I think that maybe because I admire what he did, for holding that world record for 5 years or whatever it was, that's, in a way, you kind of just expect more from him because he's been around, he's been at this game for a long time. You kind of expect him to have a little more decorum in defeat like that. So,
yeah, but it got us talking about him, but if you're going to go out in the round of 16, you got to do something, and it's either get the world record and then fall, or have a fall and try and put a hole through the speed wall. So hey, kept us talking. Natalie, tell us about your big loser from this weekend.
I've got a quick one and then a slightly different one. But first of all, Jesse Pilz. I know we talked about the top and stuff.
Yeah.
But just given that she slipped in the last two competitions and barely got off the ground and seemed really upset, to finally make the finals and then top out the route, and you could see how happy she was. And at that point, I was wondering, is she that happy because she's overcome all the, you know, mental hurdles or whatever of the last 2 weeks, or does she, is she happy because she thinks she might win? Because I'm pretty sure, you know, when she topped out, she would have realized that, you know, that route's going to get multiple tops. Mm-hmm. In some ways we're lucky it didn't get at least one or two more, but yeah, I think just for her to top that route and not get a medal was pretty gutting. I mean, I haven't seen any posts from her, or didn't really see how she reacted, but yeah, she's kind of a winner and a loser. Like, obviously it was huge progress for her, but yeah, big loser because of the route setting, I guess. But also, yeah, as John said, like all the weird things that happened, I feel like a lot of them, like these incidents, like technical incidents or incidents that cause appeals, I feel like some of them are avoidable. Like, you know, why was that bolt that Laura scummed her foot against, why was that not covered? Because like there were plenty of bolt covers all over the wall, but that one just happened not to be covered. Mm-hmm. And, you know, that's a really easy issue that you can solve. And then like the edge of wall thing, I know Jessie's tall, but it feels like we should try and set routes that aren't so close to the edge of an out of bounds area. And then timeouts, I really feel like there should be some warning signal or something when sure. a competitor's about, because, you know, it must be so frustrating for a competitor to think they've topped or think they've reached a really good high point, and then to come, you can see it, like when Brooke was like, what, like she just didn't realize that her time had run out, so why not make it a bit more audible when there's 1 minute or 10 seconds or whatever, and then time out, and it just stops us, like, you know. And the comment again, it goes back to this, you know, communicating with the broadcasting team. You know, we didn't know what was going on, the commentary team didn't know that Brooke had timed out, so it's just this kind of disconnect between athletes and officials and broadcasters and the audience that we just don't really know what's going on sometimes, but it seems easy to fix. And the quick draw thing about Alex slipping and kind of weighting it with his finger, I do wonder if one day we'll have like pressure sensors on quick draws to actually mm-hmm. check whether people adequately weighted it or not. Because like with Wimbledon, the tennis competition's been on this weekend, and they have like Hawkeye technology and all this really high tech. So like, I think the technology is out there to do this kind of thing in climbing, like even on things like bolts, like mm-hmm. pressure pads or whatever, pressure sensors. But yeah, I wonder if that's the future of trying to resolve all these little things that just cause athletes to stress and cause confusion.
Yeah, I totally agree that the bolt cover thing is kind of inexcusable. Those are certainly probably some of the cheapest holds that you end up having to buy for these events, so it is really disappointing when that happens. Yeah, the sensors in the bolt one is interesting, because I know when I say they, I don't even know who I'm talking about, but people have demoed technology where you can measure the amount of force on a climbing hold, and I think the sensor tech is in the back of the wall. So if I remember right, the difficult part of using it was you have to access the back of the wall, and so you have to know, okay, where does the hold go? So you got to like set the route and then go in and place the sensor. But if you're talking about bolts for hangers and quick draws, you would say, well, we know where those are all the time. I guess the difference being that they serve a different purpose, obviously, and the quick draws have to take technically a lot more pressure. They have to be a much more structurally sound system than just a T-nut. So I'm not really sure how that would work together, but that would be great if you can just look at it and say, you know, there was, you know, a quarter pound of force applied to it. We don't consider that use for the Laura thing even as well, right? Like how much torque was she actually putting on that? It looked like a drag. I don't know if you want to call it use or not, but I guess it turned out they decided it wasn't, which that was one of those instances where it was borderline enough, right? The trajectory of her foot was sideways and she kind of like swiped across it slowly. So I don't think she was stepping off it like many other famous incidents, but yeah, no, that is true. It is a bit disappointing that so many of them were avoidable. That's a great point. John, did you want to pipe in?
Yeah. Isn't that, I think that's probably a good role that the Olympics could play, right? In implementing some of this great new technology, because of course the IOC is a way larger entity, has way more money available, budget, all that stuff to employ this type of technology. And then maybe if we see it and it works in the Olympics, we could then apply it to the World Cup scene. It's almost like you always hear with like technology that it starts with the military,
the US, or
it starts
military
with like the space program, and then it moves into the general public, right, and stuff like that. So yeah, like have the Olympics try out some of this stuff. Maybe waiting the quick draws, maybe putting sensors even in the holds themselves to see whether somebody deserves a plus or whatever, you know, like depending on how much they moved on it. Maybe employing some of that Hawkeye type of stuff to get really close focal points on stuff. Yeah, that's great.
Can I interject? What is the Hawkeye thing? I don't know what that is.
It tracks the path of the ball somehow. Like, I don't know exactly. Oh. Is it like sensors? Like, yeah, it tracks exactly where the ball goes, so it can tell you whether it went over on the line or in or out on the court.
And is it tracking it in the air, or is it tracking it when it makes contact with the ground, so you know if it's like on the white line or not? But really, wow, that's crazy. Yeah.
I'll have to look.
So yeah, and the interesting thing about the Hawkeye too. So in just anybody that maybe doesn't follow tennis, if a ball hits on the line, it's good. Like if it's literally on the line, but if it's outside of the line, then it's out. And so there's an instance in a lot of cases to the naked eye where it's like, I don't know, that's really close. I can't tell if that was on the line or out. And so Hawkeye is this technology, this like camera that they can zoom in really closely on where the ball hit. Hmm. So you get literally like millimeters of, you can see whether the ball is in or out. And it's actually not a camera of the ball itself. I've read about it. It turns the trajectory of the ball basically into a mathematical equation. And so it can generate precisely where the ball actually hit. So it's not actually zooming in on the shot itself, but it is, I mean, it's a computer, right? Like it's perfectly accurate, more accurate than the naked eye. And so I think that just that general concept of like that kind of really precise technology could certainly have application all over the climbing world.
Yeah, they had those split holds in Tokyo, the looks of pressure holds, like so you could do splits on speed. I don't know how well
yes,
it was used.
That's true. Yeah.
I should say it took us decades to figure out just to put a hollow back hold on top of a bolt. So I'm not going to hold my breath that we develop like a radar based like force tracking system. The IFSC will have fallen and crumbled before that comes into play. But yeah, hopefully one day.
Would you both prefer to see to have an alarm that goes off like we do in bouldering when there's a minute left in lead climbing? Maybe we get the beep and then the competitors on the lead wall know that they have a minute left. Would that be something that you would like to see in lead?
I guess it just bothers me because if you're dealing with semifinals when you have multiple climbers going and their timers start when they get on the wall, I believe, not when the judge tells them to. So the timers could be different, although like very close to each other, and I'd worry about the confusion. If I'm reading that right, I'm pretty sure in semifinals you have two athletes come out at the same time, but you press the start time on the timer when they take their foot off the ground, which means you could have two climbers starting within a couple seconds of each other, and that could get pretty confusing. Yeah, I don't know. You could always just like throw your shoe at them or something. That's what I don't really know what this. You could have like a display at the top of the wall if you know where the lanes are. You could just have it just says let go. I don't know.
Or maybe just in finals, just do it in finals.
Yeah, well, finals, there's so many clocks and you only have one person on the wall, so I feel like it's a little bit easier. Like if you did want to do a signal, you could, but I don't know. It would be nice to have something because that is a bit embarrassing. It is frustrating when the expectations of an athlete get ruined. I wanted to go back to the Jesse thing really quick. I wanted to kind of gauge how you guys feel about Jesse Pills right now. Because, you know, we know what her pedigree is, and she's always been a top-tier climber. This season has been rough for her, and then we finally see a top. But, of course, it's tempered by the fact that many people topped, and it was topped by people who have been outperforming her, frankly, for the rest of the season. Any thoughts on Jesse Pills outside of this competition in isolation, where we should rank her? Like, I guess here's the question that came up in Discord was, okay, she topped the route. Is Jesse Pills the kind of person that when she tops the route, that means it's too easy? Or is Jessie Pills the kind of person that when she tops the route, that means she's probably going to be the only top? And I'm trending towards the former right now, obviously, based on her last three events, which I think is fair. But yeah, any thoughts on Jessie Pills?
I would probably trend towards the former as well. It's really hard to gauge her this season because her stumbles in the previous competitions were such flukes, right? Mm-hmm. Just foot popping, heel popping. Now that's not to say they still, like, that's part of it, right? Like she was the one who popped the heel accidentally or popped the foot. But I don't know. I think that's part of the intrigue here is that we're three comps in going on to the fourth, and we still don't really know how to gauge Jessie Pills this season. I think of all the competitors, or certainly of the competitors that we would label as the general average top 10 in the women's lead division, she is the biggest question mark at this point. I just feel like we haven't really... We don't know what she's at, where she's at this season.
Can I be honest with what I think is that I think the fact that she has won events and she has beaten Janja, including in a particularly unsatisfying way in the past at that World Championships where she won by time, I think that skews the narrative towards her being somebody that is like a consistent contender for the very best spot. I do think she's a top five athlete. It seems like she is kind of right around that number five. If you make a list of like the top five women that you always see in every event, she's pretty much one of them, I think, nearly every time. But I don't believe she's a contender for first place right now. Like I would put Cheyenne above her. I would put Natalia above her. I might start putting Brooke above her consistently. And of course, Janja right at the top. So I think
maybe Laura too.
Yes. Yeah. Laura, I think, is part of that top five, 100%. She, of course, has also had kind of a couple weird events, so I don't really know where she's at. And of course, there's always questions about her stylistically. She doesn't seem as well-rounded, possibly. But yeah, I think I don't want to call Jessie overhyped, because if she is, it's not by much. But I don't think it's reasonable to see her top a route and then, you know, the conversation in the chat was, oh, she's won, you know, world championships, she's won events before, so maybe it is actually this hard and she's just having the best day of her life. I think that's not quite an appropriate estimation. It seems like she is pretty consistently beat out by the other climbers. So I think she's kind of like earning that spot where she's one of the best climbers in the world, but she very rarely actually beats those climbers that are normally above her. So yeah. I don't know.
I think she looked strong. I think she qualified quite highly in Innsbruck, and I thought, oh, she must be on good form, and obviously didn't get to see her reach her potential in either of those events. But I think she's still fit. I think her climbing style has changed quite a lot because of the Olympics. She adapted really well to bouldering, and she's actually, I'd say she's arguably been more impressive throughout the boulder season. Like, she's made quite a lot of semifinals and just missed out on finals.
The bar is lower for her in bouldering, but I agree. It's been good seeing her be, you know, up there.
So I think that's kind of shifted her expectations, and yeah, she's probably just adapting to like new, you know, a new body, like new muscle. She's probably, yeah, I think just trying to see how her power applies to route climbing. And I think also just the level of the women's has just shot up with the likes of Brooke and Natalia, Cheyenne, and it's just a slightly bigger field. Like, I mean, ordinarily she probably would have just come second to Janja or be pushing Janja, but I think she's just got more of a fight on her hands, and we're probably just seeing the result of that.
Yeah, no kidding.
I think it is fair to say this is one of the most stacked at the top, women's lead fields that we've had in a long time. When you think about how good Brooke is climbing this year, how Natalia always has to be considered in the mix. You have Janja, of course. You have Laura. Cheyenne as well. What a top five.
It does feel like it's a period where all of our top athletes are kind of in their prime, because you only have to go back a couple of years to say, oh yeah, it is a stacked field. You've got these huge names that are legendary climbers in their late 20s, but also these young upcoming climbers who are doing really well. And I think right now where you see so many of them kind of in that 20-ish age range, right? They're all in their like very young 20s. Even though I don't want to say it's necessarily a competitive field, because it is still for the most part Janja's territory when it shows up, which kind of makes it hard to reconcile with the other periods where we've seen, you know, gold medals be won by different people consistently. It's not that kind of competitive, right? But it's cool seeing all these athletes where we don't really have a reason to doubt their performance, right? It's not Jane Kim in 2019 where she's, you know, now in her 30s and definitely at the end of a career. It's not Chayun when she's 15 being incredibly talented, but we don't know how far it's going to go. We don't know if it's a fluke for a year. We don't know if she's going to do the full Johanna Ernst burnout or something like that. Like, it seems like we have a really healthy core field of peak athletes, which is really satisfying. And it feels like they're all going to be around for a while. So I'm not worried about any of them retiring, right? Like, all of them are probably in this for a couple more years, as long as they can hang with whatever kids come up from underneath. So yeah, it is a really satisfying squad at the top for sure. Yeah, let's do some honorable mentions if anybody has any. I actually don't have any off the top of my head. I was kind of going to mention the Chinese speed team, but I think I'm going to wait until the fall when we have those last two events, and especially when we can get out to Jakarta, hopefully. And maybe we'll talk about them in more depth, especially if Alexandra Miroslav shows up again. I'd really like to measure them against that. But anyways, please, Natalie, if you want to go first, if you have an honorable mention for anything.
I quite liked the range of camera angles. I thought they did quite a good job with the on-camera, on-wall cameras. Even though sometimes it felt like you needed slightly wider view to try and gauge where they were on the wall. There was that moment when Natalia seemed to look right into the camera, and I thought that was quite good. Like, we're getting a lot better at getting the expressions of the climbers, and you can more accurately figure out how pumped they are, how tired they are by their expressions on the faces, which is quite fun.
Yeah, I will say I've got just a few honorable mentions real quick here that I suppose would go in the winners category for honorable mention. Taisei Hama, he doesn't win gold, but he shows that, I mean, he's like seriously consistent here. And I know we always say, well, how much do you weight a person after just one fantastic round or one fantastic weekend? Well, now we're kind of seeing maybe Taisei Hama is here to stay, at least for this season, at the top, always kind of near that podium spot. Also, we've talked about her, but Laura Rigora should be applauded because she got fourth in Innsbruck, fourth in Villar. She finally breaks onto a podium here in Chamonix. So great stuff for Laura. And then I guess I'll bookend close here with what I was talking about at the beginning, which was some of the speed stuff. Honorable mention to Li Juandang and Jinbao Long, the speed winners in the men's and women's division. I think it looks like they are coming for that world records in each, the men's and the women's, or at least coming for a shot at it. You look at Li Juandang, clocks a 6.55 here in Chamonix. That is razor close to that world record mark. And then Jinbao Long clocks a 5.07, which is equally razor close to that men's world record. So I think there are going to be fireworks as the speed season continues. I think we're going to see some really great stuff, especially if we can get to your point, Tyler, Li Juandang lining up against Ola in the women's, if we can get Jinbao Long lining up against Kira Mal in the men's division, I think we very well might see some more world records get broken.
Yeah, I think the men's side is very satisfying right now, because I feel like for the most part we have all of the legit representatives still showing up, with Alexandra not attending the last two events. It does make it a little less satisfying. I would love to see her climb against those new climbers that have shown up in the last, like, literally 2 weeks. I think that's really exciting. I don't think that's accurate. They've been competing in World Cups in the past. But with the performances that they have right now, I would like to see that head-to-head, because Ola was looking indomitable, like just absolutely crushing it. And I'm curious if that would hold up with these new athletes that show up in the last couple events. So yeah, I just the stupid mention that I started laughing when Natalia had that looking down the barrel of the camera moment. It reminded me of those wildlife cameras where you put like a camera in a bird feeder or something, and just an animal just ends up just gazing straight at you. That's all I could think about in that moment. I thought that was really funny. But yeah, anyway. This has been the debrief for the Chamonix Speed and Lead World Cup of 2022. We'll be back for Briançon in a couple weeks. Of course, in between then is the World Games happening in Birmingham, Alabama. We'll be talking about that in the Plastic Weekly Discord. So if you'd like to chat about some of the best climbers in the world, check the link in the description. You can come hang out and talk about everything that's happening. If there's a public stream, we might all watch it together live, especially if you're in North America. If you want to support shows like this, you can support Plastic Weekly on our Patreon, which is also in the link below. And of course, make sure you leave your thoughts in the comments. Leave a like, maybe subscribe. And as always, thank you to Natalie for joining us this week, and John for joining us week after week. And with that, we will see you in the next one.